being done, then you plan surgery, then histopathology, and further management adjuvant treatment would be guided by histopathology. I'm not going to go into the details, but just these slides I'm going to flash to look show the importance of history and examination and the details to which you must go when you want to palpate the orbit. Under each of these headings, there are subheadings. Each of these has to be elicited and recorded wherever possible. Not to forget the rest of the eye, Schirmer's test is extremely important when you're looking at lacrimal gland lesions. Cranial nerve examination is important, and in patients where you suspect that there's a secondary lesion coming from the paranasal sinus, nose, etc., or the tumor extending to those areas, then you must examine those areas as well. Then comes imaging, and finally you're ready with your differential diagnosis. A gross differential diagnosis, whether it's a congenital lesion, possible infection, inflammation, traumatic lesion, or a neoplastic. This is very, very gross classification. Then you're suspecting a tumor, then you clinically determine whether it is a primary tumor, most likely, or likely to be a secondary tumor. And if you think it's a primary tumor, whether it is benign or malignant. Then you go into further subclassification. Actually, clinically, at the end of a good clinical evaluation and imaging, you should be able to at least narrow down your differential diagnosis to two or three of these. Not just based on the appearance of the tumor on imaging and the way it feels when you palpate it, but also you should go by the epidemiology in your region. For example, in adults in India, at least, the top four are these: lymphoproliferative, vascular, secondary, and cystic. Then come the subgroup of neurogenic inflammation, mesenchymal, and lacrimal gland lesions. Then rest of these are minor. So depending on what lesions are more common and what kind of pathology has it produced, is it a well-circumscribed intraconal mass, then your differential diagnosis is narrowed down to only four or five. If it's a well-circumscribed extraconal superior orbital lesion, again, your differential diagnosis is narrowed down to just two or three. So all that having been taken into consideration, you go to the next step. But I'm not going into the details of all this. These can be covered separately. Now, once you've done all this logical stepwise approach, then you go to a clinical radiological differential diagnosis. Then you arrive at this particular question. After having gone through the entire protocol, you come to answer this question. Do I do surgery? Certain cases, the answer is a clear no. You will not do surgery. In some cases, the answer is a clear yes. You'll definitely want to do surgery. And in some cases, they just sit on the fence. Maybe surgery, may not be surgery, because surgery may have its risks, surgery may have its benefits, and surgery may or may not be required in a particular case. So this is a narrow gray zone. This is not a very wide gray zone. Most of the cases actually fit under absolute answers, yes or no. Gray zone, of course, has to be dealt with depending on your clinical experience. These are examples where I would never want to do surgery. This is a child with bilateral proptosis, asymmetrical but bilateral nevertheless. You can see temporal fossa fullness. And on imaging, we found a triradiate lesion centered in the sphenoid wing with extension to temporal fossa, orbit, and intracranial. So this is a metastatic blooms for sure. No need for a biopsy. The child goes to a pediatric oncologist. Now, if you have an exactly similar situation, but with racunai sign or periocular ecchymosis, subconjunctival hemorrhage, again, a triradiate lesion centered in the sphenoid wing, temporal fossa, orbit, intracranial extension, it's a metastatic neuroblastoma. Again, definite no to surgery. Child with unilateral proptosis, we can see subconjunctival hemorrhage here. Fundus showed rod spots, and peripheral blood smear was all that was required to diagnose AML in this child with a granulocytic sarcoma. So again, no surgery here. A patient with a prior history of multiple myeloma, punched out lesions in the skull, and a triradiate lesion, again with temporal fossa, intracranial, and orbital extension. Suspicion is plasmacytoma. You don't really have to do surgery here. You simply confirm the diagnosis by doing fine needle aspiration cytology. And of course, the patient has to go to an oncologist. Now, there are non-surgical approach to orbital tumors as well. This patient doesn't obviously have a proptosis, but during his medical examination, he was found to have reduced vision in the right eye. And that is caused by a deep intraconal lesion, which is abutting against the optic nerve and the superior orbital fissure. In fact, it is coning into the superior orbital fissure. It's peeping into the superior orbital fissure. Looking at its flow characteristics, it's a cavernous hemangioma for sure. There's no doubt. And it's a surgeon's delight. Cavernous hemangioma is generally excised with a lot of pleasure by surgeons because it comes out very beautifully. But what are the possibilities if you were to meddle in the superior orbital fissure, orbital apical area? You might produce trauma to the optic nerve. You might cause subtle diptopia. So this patient who currently does not have much of functional problem except visual field defect may end up with loss of vision or permanent diplopia. And if he were to have a crucial occupation such as being a pilot, this patient was one, then what do you do? You have to deal with the tumor, but at the same time, produce minimal complications. And you can choose to not operate these patients, but provide stereotactic radiation. This doesn't completely resolve the tumor, but it shrinks the tumor enough to cause reversal of visual field effect. This is the patient that we began with, tumor in the superior orbital fissure, optic canal area. Following radiation, it has shrunk to about 20 to 30% of its initial volume, and the visual field defect has returned to normal. So this is one good indication where you can provide alternative modalities of care in patients where surgery may do more harm than good. This is actually from the literature where gamma knife radiation, much lower dose of 2000 centigrade was used in this patient where a much smaller lesion was severely compressing the optic nerve causing visual field defect. Following gamma knife radiation, the authors reported that visual field returned to normal and the tumor size reduced to about 50% of its initial volume. That was good enough for kind of a decompression effect. So the current dictum is that if you have a tumor which is in the shape of a pear peeping into the superior orbital fissure, surgery may not be a good option. And if you already know clinically radiologically that it's a cavernous hemangioma, then stereotactic radiation may be an option. If you think that it is a malignant tumor, then of course you can do a very cautious biopsy, do an intraoperative diagnosis using frozen section or rapid diagnostics techniques such as squash and imprint cytology, confirm the diagnosis and proceed forward depending on what the histopathology says. The next group of disorders can be treated with injections. Patients with lymphangioma, for that matter, they have tumor in very critical locations. This lady does not have any functional problem at all. Her only concern is subtle proptosis, which is cosmetically disfiguring as per her, and also frequent subconjunctival and periocular hemorrhage because of lymphangioma that she has. Now, she has a tumor which is all around the optic nerve, medial rectus, SRLPS complex, and the lateral rectus. Even if you go in from a safe supratemporal aspect, there is still a chance of a secondary bleeding. There is still a chance of optic nerve damage because the tumor is all around it. There's still a chance of diplopia, and she doesn't have any of this preoperatively. So if she wants only cosmesis, then you won't want to do surgery in this patient. Rather, inject the lesion either with picibanil or bleomycin. Picibanil is expensive. It has to be imported with drug license. Logistically, it's difficult to acquire, but it is a very good drug. You can see in this patient that the intraconal component has nearly totally gone. Extraconal component is also nearly totally gone. And she has got back her cosmesis. So this drug works very well. 1 to 3 injections is what we give right into the lesion. If it's a macrocystic lymphangioma, you have to aspirate the lesion and inject. If it's a microcystic lymphangioma, you don't have to aspirate and simply inject. So this is the post-injection appearance. This is an example of a macrocystic lymphangioma where there was about 7 cc of blood in the chocolate cyst that had formed because of bleeding. Somebody had attempted a biopsy elsewhere and you can see a small scar there, but they couldn't reach the tumor from the supranasal aspect. All that we did was, this is minimal interventional. We aspirated the lesion and then we injected equal amount of bleomycin. This was an early case. Currently, we inject just 50% of the aspirate volume if it's a macrocystic lymphangioma, and 25% of the volume of the lesion, estimated volume of the lesion, radiologically estimated volume of the lesion, if it's a microcystic lymphangioma. So that's it. And these patients do very well. As you see here, the same patient following aspiration of the chocolate cyst and injection of bleomycin, then patient is doing well. Only a tip here is that when you aspirate, you leave the needle right into the macrocystic cavity without moving the needle. You have to simply switch the syringe from the one which has aspirated blood to one which is containing bleomycin. The needle remains exactly where it is. You simply switch the syringe so that you get right into the macrocystic cavity and don't inject somewhere else where the lesion may not be there. This is a patient again with a sudden intralesional hemorrhage in a case with lymphangioma, settled on very well. But here there was a suspicion of a solid lesion. Solid lesion in the sense that it could be a necrotic rhabdomyosarcoma. It was that was the kind of radiological appearance this patient had. So in such patients, what we do is we do a small incisional biopsy from a safer approach. So we did an incisional biopsy, confirmed on the table that it was indeed lymphangioma, then injected. So there is an option for that as well. You can open up, do a small incisional biopsy in a confounding situation, and under visualization, inject bleomycin or bisavanil, and these patients do well. This was an anterior lymphangioma, so you can debulk the anterior component. This patient was debulked by the transconjunctival approach. The anterior component was debulked and the retrobulbar component was injected with bleomycin. You can see this patient who has both proptosis as well as displacement. So there's an anterior component here which was debulked and the retrobulbar component was injected. These are very easy to treat. Anterior lymphangiomas, extremely accessible. You don't even need radiological guidance during injection. Simply aspirate and inject and they do well. Now, one more group of lesions which are amenable to injections are eosinophilic granulomas. These come with scary appearance. You can see that the bone is completely destroyed here. Superior orbital wall is gone and the dura seems intact, but it is indented. It seems infiltrated. The treatment of choice for eosinophilic granuloma conventionally is curettage. Now, you can curette this patient, but what is the consequence? You might injure the dura and the patient may have CSF leak. And if you do incomplete curettage, the lesion doesn't really go away. So what do we do here? Short of curettage, we can do a safe incisional biopsy right from the center of the lesion without disturbing the dura or going close to the roof. Confirm the diagnosis by an intraoperative frozen section. The pathologist will give you the diagnosis in about 10 to 15 minutes. Then under direct visualization, inject the lesion with 40 milligram of triamcinolone. 20 to 40 milligram is the dose that is injected. And over a period of time, you can see that there is remodeling of the bone. This is in 3 months, the bone got remodeled. And at the end of 6 months, there is complete remodeling of the bone and complete resolution of proptosis, which would not have been possible with curettage. You can see nearly symmetrical remodeling of the orbit. In fact, with little amount of hyperostosis in that area, that was possible with intralesional injection. One more recent case where we injected, of course, you have to do biopsy to inject because you really don't know what it is unless they have systemic manifestations. You can see that this lesion within 3 months has reduced to this size and bone remodeling is already taking place and small amount of area that is residual that can be re-injected. The third group of disorders are where you do incisional biopsy. Now, incisional biopsy is specifically for suspected malignant tumors, poorly localized and infiltrative lesions. That means that if a tumor, whether it is benign or malignant, if it's very well circumscribed, and does not have any association with any of the functionally crucial structures such as extraocular muscles and the optic nerve, you want to completely excise it. There is no doubt about that. If it's a well-circumscribed lesion without functional consequences, benign or malignant, excision is the treatment of choice. But if it's a suspected malignant lesion, poorly localized and infiltrative, associated with crucial structures, then you would want to do an incisional biopsy because you don't know what it is. And some of these patients may be amenable to medical management and radiation. You don't have to do surgical intervention at all. You don't have to meddle with their functional integrity of the eye and vision. So you do an incisional biopsy to confirm the diagnosis and then plan your treatment accordingly. With incisional biopsy, you also have a scope for doing intraoperative diagnosis. That will help you in a lot of ways. Suppose a patient has a tumor which is closely associated with lateral rectus muscle and you have to sacrifice lateral rectus to completely take it out. Suppose you find that it is just an inflammatory lesion by an intraoperative diagnosis. You don't have to proceed with further surgery at all. This patient can be medically managed. Suppose you find that it is a histiocytic lesion. Of course, you stop surgery then and there without doing further damage at all to any of the functionally crucial structures. This can be treated with steroids or even radiation. So incisional biopsy has to be planned very critically. Now, what is the problem with incisional biopsy? This is from the literature. About 8 to 20% of orbital biopsies result in non-specific or misleading diagnosis, which means that the diagnosis, correct diagnosis may not be forthcoming, or there could be wrong diagnosis, which will lead you to a wrong track of diagnosis and management. This is mainly because of unrepresentative sample. Unrepresentative sample in the sense that if this is a particular lesion, the superficial biopsy may actually contain tissue reaction to a particular lesion. Example, if it's a round cell tumor, if this is a round cell tumor, say rhabdomyosarcoma, now around the lesion, because round cell tumors have a component of necrosis, there'll be tissue reaction, which would be inflammation and fibrosis. So there will be a zone of inflammation and there'll be a zone of fibrosis. If you do a biopsy to say 20% or one third of depth, you'll only catch inflammation and fibrosis. If you go to mid periphery of the lesion, you will find the tumor. This is where exactly you'll find the tumor. The central area may actually have necrosis. So if you enter the lesion right to the center and don't bother to do a mid peripheral biopsy or a peripheral biopsy, you might find only necrotic element. If you do only a peripheral biopsy, you might find inflammation and fibrosis. So the most crucial zone for a round cell tumor is the mid zone. So that is how it is. Similarly, if it's a lymphoproliferative lesion, for example, if it's a lacrimal gland lesion, which is like this. Now, if you approach it from transeptal or say transperiosteal approach, whatever approach you might want to do, part of the lesion may actually be benign reactive lymphoid hyperplasia. Part of the lesion may be atypical lymphoid hyperplasia, and rest of it may be lymphoma. We know it. Lymphoma is a marching disease. There are elements of benign reactive lymphoid hyperplasia, atypical lymphoid hyperplasia, and lymphoma in the same lesion. So how to make sure that you get a representative sample? You always estimate the depth of the tumor or lesion on CT scan and go to nearly the entire depth of the lesion layer by layer. That means that if this is the lesion that you're sampling, you start with the initial one third, then you go to the middle one third, then you go to the bottom one third. So all these samples have to be sent to the pathologist, and the pathologist will tell you what is the correct diagnosis. I'll show you some examples. This was a child who presented with subacute proptosis, several weeks proptosis. So always do biopsy from superficial, mid-zonal, and deep. So we have access to histopathology of each of these zones. Now the pathologist, when he looked at the superficial biopsy, saw only inflammation and fibrosis, very characteristic. So suppose I had restricted my biopsy only to superficial zone, then I would have assumed that this child has some sort of atypical inflammation. I would have treated him with steroids, which would have led to a wrong treatment. Now, in the deep biopsy and mid zone, we found characteristics of embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma. So superficial biopsy showed only inflammation and fibrosis. This is a young patient with acquired hypertelorism. So his eyes have grown apart over a period of time. It is more pronounced on the left side, asymmetric, but hypertelorism, or you can even call it telecanthus. You can see that there are lesions, soft tissue lesions in the supratemporal aspect, supranasal aspect in both eyes. It could be anything. When we did a biopsy, we found superficial biopsy, we found inflammation and fibrosis. Deep biopsy showed granulomatous inflammation and multinucleate giant cells. when special stains were performed, GMS stain, we saw fungal element. So this was a fungal granuloma. Here again, if you were to do only a superficial biopsy, we would have interpreted this as inflammation and possibly treated this patient with steroids with worsening of his underlying condition. So dictum is that if you have a pediatric or an adult round cell tumor, it's the intermediate zone that contains the lesion. If it's lymphoma, again, you should look for an intermediate zone that contains a lesion. If it's granulomatous inflammation of non-specific etiology, the deep zone of the lesion is classic. And if it's a fungus, then obviously the deep zone would contain fungus, which can be stained with special stains. Fungus generally doesn't grow from orbital lesion. You might even want to do a PCR, pan-fungal PCR, but special stains are positive from deep zone. And TB again, unless it is a periosteal variant of a TB, it's the deep zone. It's a that is positive for tubercular etiology. So in orbital biopsy, I would say that we should do a layered biopsy, estimate the epicenter of the lesion, or the what we call is epicenter is the radiological center of the lesion. If this is a lesion, if you draw a line from the largest horizontal diameter and largest vertical diameter, wherever it meets is the epicenter. So if you're doing a biopsy in this patient, you should go superficial, mid-zonal and deep, right past the epicenter of the lesion. And that is an ideal biopsy. And the depth is estimated by CT or MRI. Then when you send a biopsy specimen, not just send for histopathology, in a suspected case, you should always send for microbiology as well. And keep some additional fresh tissue for special stains and PCR. Suppose the pathologist suspects tuberculosis and you have used up all the tissue for formalin fixation, then you may not have enough tissue for PCR. So that is why you should keep some additional tissue for special tests that may come in handy. And whenever there is a doubt, you should do frozen section or imprint squash intraoperative diagnosis, which is critical. Now, if you have any doubt at all whether you have reached the representative part of the tumor, you can always use intraoperative navigation, which is a good tool to reach, know where exactly you are within the lesion before you start your biopsy. Now, the advantages of doing a biopsy are this. This is a patient who looks very bad initially, but he actually has just a mantle cell lymphoma, and without any stigma at all of any of the surgical interventions, he got completely cured with a very simple protocol of bendamustine and rituximab. So if you know what the diagnosis is, many of these patients are amenable to chemotherapy, radiation, or a combination of both, or even target therapy. The surgical intervention actually is overkill. Now going on to excisional biopsy. Whatever may be the tumor, as I said, benign or malignant, if it's well circumscribed and localized, non-infiltrative, not associated with crucial structures, with minimal risk of functional deficit, then you want to completely excise it. Of course, there are corollaries to this rule, which I'll elucidate a little later. Now, surgical approaches are neurosurgical, endonasal, which I'm not going to talk about. I'm only going to talk about orbital approaches. I'm going to first confuse you with a lot of terminology, because I think the audience are at various levels. Some of you may be residents, some of you may be fellows, and some of you may be very consummate orbital surgeons. Since there is a varied group of individuals who are listening to this, I would like to put in some theory first, so that at least those who are in the middle of their training would get totally confused. And then I will bring in some clarity by showing practical aspects of how to approach a particular orbital lesion. Now, anyway, in orbit, the approach depends on whether the lesion is anterior, mid-orbit, or deep orbit. Anterior orbitotomy is a classic approach. Now, when you talk about anterior orbitotomy, you have four approaches. Transcutaneous, that means you approach from the skin side. Transconjunctival, that means you approach from the conjunctival side. Combined, where you cut a little bit of skin and a little bit of conjunctiva. And of course, coronal approach is always there, which I'm not going to talk about. Now let's go zone by zone. This is actually Rootman's way of making things very systematic. He has classified incisions and approaches as anterior, mid and deep, And for anterior, there is cutaneous and conjunctival. Cutaneous and conjunctival are again classified as superior and inferior, superior orbital and inferior orbital. Zone-wise approach, basically. In superior, you have medial, central, and lateral. Inferior, you have lateral and central taken together, and medial. In superior medial, you can be either anterior or posterior to the trochlea. In inferior medial, you can be anterior or posterior to the lacrimal sac. So this is the basic classification of approaches to the anterior orbitotomy. Now, anterior, superior, medial, anterior to the trochlea, there are three incisions. So I think you're with me. So I'm talking about anterior, superior, medial first, and there, anterior to the trochlea, there are three approaches: transeptal, eyelid crease, and modified Lynch. All are cutaneous. I'll come to conjunctival a little later. Now, if a lesion is superficial, vaguely palpable, it is posterior to the orbital septum, likely malignant, so a direct approach is required, and you're planning either an incisional or an excisional biopsy. If it's a medial supranasal lesion, then you would do a transeptal approach. Transeptal approach is a direct approach, which means that you don't have to create a skin muscle flap. Suppose you approach a lesion by a lid crease, then you have to create a skin muscle flap to a certain extent and then enter the lesion or go to the zone of the lesion. If it's a malignant tumor, what happens when you make this skin muscle flap and reach the lesion and then do an incisional biopsy within the lesion, all this area will be seeded microscopically or macroscopically with tumor cells. So if it's a tumor which you cannot completely excise and you have to do radiation, then it is extremely difficult for a radiation oncologist to plan radiation in this patient. I have seen several cases of adenoid cystic carcinoma of the lacrimal gland completely cured in the lacrimal gland region, but they have manifested with nodules in the area where the initial incision, lid crease incision was made. So if you suspect a malignant tumor, I actually, from wearing the hat of an oncologist, I would never want anybody to do a remote approach. That means that for a malignant lesion, you are better off with a direct approach right on top of the lesion, not to worry about cosmesis. If you actually take care of your suturing well, if you suture orbicularis and skin well, there is hardly any scar, and there are any number of scar modulators currently available, so you can actually do away with a visible scar in about 6 weeks or 3 months with proper treatment and proper suturing. So never bother about cosmesis. You will definitely achieve it. Bother about the fact that you want to do an oncologically sound approach, and that has to be a direct approach. So transeptal approach is for lesions which are likely malignant, where you want to do a direct approach, or a benign lesion where you want to completely remove it. If it's a palpable anterior lesion, supranasally, you would want to do transeptal approach. Now, if it's a benign lesion and you want to do an excisional biopsy, you can definitely do a medial lid crease incision for a supranasal lesion. So this is definitely an alternative. But if the lesion is more medial than supromedial, suppose the lesion is somewhere here, more medial, not supromedial, then a modified Lynch incision is a possibility. We hardly use these days. Even if we use it, we restrict it to somewhere to this area, extreme supranasally, and don't have this medial extension generally as orbital surgeons. But well, this is a good incision, by the way. This will give you a lot of exposure to the orbit, medial orbit, especially for deep extracoronal lesions, which are close to periosteum, and extraperiosteal lesions. So this is a good incision. So we are still talking about anterior, superior, medial approaches anterior to the trochlea. Now, if you want to do an approach posterior to the trochlea, then again, you have a direct approach, which is right under the brow, direct approach posterior to the trochlea. So you can retract the superior oblique muscle, and you can sometimes even disinsert the trochlea and put it back, So this is a direct approach. So this is for superficial or deep lesions, which may or may not be palpable, likely malignant because it's a direct approach, either immediately subperiosteal or extraperiosteal in the supranasal orbit. There's a conjunctival incision as well, supranasal orbit. It is uncomplicated and it can be easily used for tumors which are very close to the eyeball. So whenever you use an incision which is close to the orbital margin, it is for lesions which are generally I'm talking about lesions which are extraconal or extraperiosteal. When you're using a conjunctival incision, except in the inferior, infralateral and the medial aspect, whenever you use a transconjunctival incision in the supranasal, superior or supralateral approach, it's mainly for lesions which are very close to the eyeball. These are the best approaches. So transconjunctival supranasal approach is also there. Then we go to anterior, superior, central. Anterior, superior, central, we have eyelid crease incision, and the approach after you make the eyelid crease incision is either anterior or posterior to vitreous ligament. You have subro approach, you have conjunctival approach and the coronal approach. So this is an eyelid crease incision where you are approaching the tumor which is anterior to the vitreous ligament. So if you have a lesion which is anterior to vitreous ligament, or you go all along in the suborbicularis plane and then you enter somewhere there, you're bypassing the LPS at all. So there is no incidence of postoperative ptosis. So basically this is for posterior to the septum. Now there is one more incision which is through the vitreous ligament. So you can actually make an incision in the vitreous ligament and then go posterior to it. This is very rarely used. I won't use this because this causes ptosis. I would rather approach this particular tumor by a safe subro incision, which will bypass the levator. So you have an option of making a transverse cut in the levator and then getting to the lesion by a lid crease approach, or with the same lid crease approach, go all the way to the superior orbital margin, incise the periosteum and come that way, thus bypassing the LPS muscle altogether. Now we also have the subro approaches inside. So this is subro approach is a very nice incision. This is also going to work very well for lesions which are immediately subperiosteal or extraperiosteal. Now let's come to anterior, superior, central conjunctival incision. So as I already said, any conjunctival incision in the supranasal, superior and lateral aspect are for lesions which are very close to the eyeball. Say you want to do a incisional biopsy of an orbital lymphoma, part of which is extending into the superior fornix. So this is the approach. Or if you have, a dermolipoma, superior supratemporal lesion, this is the approach. So something that is close to the eyeball. Now let's go to anterior, superior, lateral. Again, you use a lid crease incision for anterior, superior, lateral approach. This is extremely good for lacrimal gland tumors, extraconal or intraconal tumors. This is a very versatile incision. In fact, about 40 to 50% of all orbitotomies are performed by an anterior, superior, lateral eyelid crease or a direct approach. This can be used for superficial and deep lesions, extraconal or intraconal lesions, for anything for that matter. In fact, in many of these patients, you don't have to touch the bone at all. This is used for non-bone cut surgery. But suppose it's a deeper lesion, then still you don't have to cut the bone. You don't have to do lateral orbitotomy. You can still resort to anterior orbitotomy, but you can do what is called marginotomy. So you nibble off some portion of the orbital margin. For example, all this overhanging orbital margin can be removed either by using a burr or DCR punch, so that you get a deeper view into the orbit just by removing this overhanging thinned out bone. You don't have to do a bone cut. Now, subro incision is also used in the lateral aspect, but generally for predominantly bony lesions, this lesion is in the bone, or for triradiate lesions which are in this configuration, which are likely malignant. No, anterior superior lateral conjunctival incision is hardly ever used. Suprotemporal conjunctival incision you should not use because you will be damaging the ducts of the lacrimal gland. So if at all, if it's a subconjunctival lesion on the lateral side, like here, you can definitely use a conjunctival approach. Now let's go to anterior, inferior, lateral and central. Anterior, inferior, lateral and central, the most common incision that is used is a swinging eyelid incision. Now what is a swinging eyelid incision? It starts in the conjunctival side like that, fornicial incision, with a lateral canthotomy with or without an inferior cantholysis. So this is a, I would say this is the most common transconjunctival approach for orbital tumors. Whenever you want to excise a tumor which is in the inferior medial, inferior, infralateral, and even to that extent lateral and supralateral, not extremely supralateral like this, but lateral and supralateral, all these tumors can be excised by a swinging eyelid incision. You can also use a transcutaneous incision or subciliary incision for preseptal lesions. This tumor is actually quite anterior. You can go from the conjunctival side, but short of it, you can always do a lower lid crease incision or a pretracheal incision in this situation. You can also use a direct approach for suspected malignant lesions right on top of the tumor. And you can also use a combined conjunctival and split canthal approach. So this is a T-shaped incision where you make an incision just short of the lateral fornix in the conjunctiva, then make a lateral canthotomy. This is good for deeper lateral lesions which are close to the eyeball. Now, anterior inferior conjunctival incision. This is again a fornicial incision. This is typically used for orbital fracture repair without cutting the lateral canthus or doing an inferior cantholysis. But this can also be used to remove tumors. Now, the last is about anterior inferior medial approach. Anterior inferior medial approach can be either anterior to the lacrimal sac for superficial lesions in relationship to the lacrimal sac. So suppose a lesion is suspected to be arising from the lacrimal sac or is in relationship to the lacrimal sac, you don't want to go posterior to it. You stay anterior to it. So this is anterior to the lacrimal sac. If you want to go posterior to the lacrimal sac, you can go directly or by going through the caruncle or through the fornix. This is a direct approach to go posterior to the lacrimal sac, something which is inframedial, mid-orbital, extra or immediately subperiosteal. This is a correct approach. Or you want to go medial transconjunctival. That is how you go for medial transconjunctival, inframedial transconjunctival, or you can go transcaruncular. Transcaruncular approach is extremely good. You make an incision either at the plica, caruncle, or in between both. And you angulate a blunt tip scissor at about 45 degree angle and reach posterior to the posterior lacrimal crest. So without disturbing the lacrimal sac, you'll be able to get into the medial orbit by doing a transcaruncular approach. And finally, if it's a lesion of the lacrimal sac and the nasolacrimal duct, then you do almost a DCR kind of an incision. But if the lesion is extending right into the nasolacrimal duct, then you can combine it with a lateral rhinotomy incision as well for complete removal of the nasolacrimal duct and the associated bone along with the lacrimal sac for a malignant lesion of the lacrimal sac. Now, I think, how much time do I have, Seema?
Sir, I think we can go on. I mean, if you have time to extend beyond 8.
No, I don't want to extend beyond 8, but I'd like to cover some of the videos if possible. I can go on for some more time.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So that was the confusing part of the theory. Now, theory is theory, but then you have to, most of orbit is common sense. You know, you don't have to name incisions. You really don't have to know the names of the incisions, but you can still make those incisions. But if you know the names and all, you obviously as postgraduates and fellows, you get those brownie points and you have something to talk about in conferences, etc. But you really don't have to know the name. You really don't have to know the specific approaches, but it is absolutely common sense. what you see on CT scan and MRI and what you palpate will actually guide as to what incision you would want to use. So what I'm coming to now is the practical approach. But still, you have to know the names. Medial perilimbal incision goes by the name of Galbraith and Sullivan. Then there is lateral perilimbal. These are all anterior transconjunctival. These are the incisions that we commonly use. Transcarrancular incision goes by the name of Balkan Goldberg. Then there is lateral canthal incision without any name. Then inferior fornicial with lateral canthotomy goes by the name of McCord-Moses. So if you do a inferior fornicial incision with a lateral canthotomy, then you're doing a McCord-Moses incision. Then you can do the same thing, inferior fornicial incision with a transcarrancular approach. Actually, you can combine all three. If you have a large lesion, I'll show you one of those cases. You can combine a transcarrancular incision with inferior fornicial, lateral canthal, and inferior cantholysis. So now with this, you can get to see about 3/4 of the orbit or 2/3 of the orbit very easily. This is a panoramic incision. So minimal excess surgery is all in the conjunctiva. This is a patient where there is orbital teratoma, and this is a child who is less than 3 months old. And you can see a fully grown tooth inside it, confirming the clinical diagnosis of orbital teratoma. It is pressing on the eye very badly, and the eyeball, the posterior aspect is squarish. And on scan, we found that the lesion was on both the medial as well as the lateral side of the optic nerve. So here we use that swinging eyelid incision with a medial extension. With that, we could easily dissect the lateral cystic component of the lesion and see the optic nerve. You can see the optic nerve was never touched, but just to show you, the surgery was performed under microscope. You can see that pearly white structure is the optic nerve, and medial to it is the solid lesion. Now the entire lesion could be removed by this incision, and that is the groove for the optic nerve. This was lateral cystic component, and that was the medial solid component. No other incision would have helped us remove it completely like this, and the child did well without any stigma of surgery. We didn't have to do the bone cut, nothing. Of course, he does have esotropia, which needs correction, but his disc appearance returned to normal. Now, this is an incision. This is a patient where there is a cavernous hemangioma in the posterior intraconal space. This is a very good indication for transconjunctival approach. So you'll see the video of transconjunctival orbitotomy here. This is a classic approach where you begin with a lateral canthotomy, about 8 to 10 millimeter lateral canthotomy, and a inferior cantholysis. This gives you a lot of space in the inferior orbit. Then inferior fornicial incision. It's called fornicial, but it is not right at the fornix, but a few millimeter away from the fornix. Then you retract all the tissues, use a lid spatula, hitch it against the inferior orbital margin, and go straight to the inferior orbital margin. About a millimeter from the inferior orbital margin is where you make your incision in the periosteum. Don't go away from it because you don't want to damage the infraorbital nerve. Then start dissecting the periosteum, periorbita, until you reach either of the two endpoints. The endpoints are the apex of this inferior orbital fissure, beyond which if you go, you'll be damaging structures, and also there'll be a lot of bleeding. And also the infraorbital nerve, beyond which you really don't have to go. Then you take time to cauterize all the perforating vessels, which will otherwise irritate you by constant oozing. Then you make a crescentric incision in the periorbita. You know where exactly is the tumor located. So use retractors, visualize the tumor, and use blunt-tipped instruments to dissect about 60 to 70% of the tumor. Then you apply a cryoprobe to the apex of the tumor, wait for a large ice ball to form, and simply wriggle the tumor out by supporting it posteriorly. But as the tumor comes out, you have to look for a posterior vascular pedicle. If you see one, you have to cauterize it, otherwise there will be secondary bleeding. Now, all that is required in this case now is to close the lateral canthal angle to give it that nice shape and close the conjunctiva. So closure is extremely easy, and this is not a watertight closure. So if there is any postoperative ooze, it has space to come out, it is out. So you use 4 to 5 or maybe 6 to 8 sutures in the inferior fornix, and that's it. these patients do very well following surgery, and this is the same patient after about a couple of weeks following surgery. She does not have the stigma of orbitotomy. She doesn't have those edematous, you know, erythematous, ecchymotic appearance. She doesn't have any of that. They recover very rapidly, and they can go back to work without any issue. This surgery actually is much faster than having to do a lateral orbitotomy, bone cut, transcutaneous approach. This is very fast and very gratifying. Now, all these other patients at various locations of tumors have been operated by transconjunctival approach. This is a young child actually with a cavernous hemangioma. You can see a cavernous hemangioma in the infromedial aspect that's been removed by the medial transconjunctival approach. This is a neurilemma of the infraorbital nerve pushing the eye up, and the lesion is here, and that is the nerve, infraorbital nerve, from which it is arising by the inferior fornicial approach. This is a fibrous histiocytoma of the infrotemporal aspect, and it was actually infiltrating the infraorbital nerve. You can see that's the infraorbital nerve. It is whitish here, it was infiltrating. And infraorbital nerve, which it was infiltrating, also had to be sacrificed in this case. And this was also getting into the inferior orbital fissure, but it was a fairly easy surgery by the transconjunctival approach. Now, transconjunctival approach can also be used for, say, optic nerve. You know, this is a patient with benign intracranial hypertension where supranasal transconjunctival approach can be used. I'll show you how simple it is. Before I did it, I was very worried how it would come out. But, you know, this is a very, fairly simple approach, I would say. All I'm doing is not exactly at the limbus, but 3 to 4 millimeter away from the limbus, a supranasal conjunctival incision, a subtenens dissection. It's almost real time. It went very quick. That's the medial rectus being hooked. And you bridle it using a 4-0 suture. Superior rectus being hooked, and you again bridle it using a 4-0 suture. So once you do this, you retract the eyeball laterally and inferiorly, bring in an orbital retractor and follow the course of the vessels, and there you see the optic nerve. So as easy as that. Supranasal approach is very easy, and that is the optic nerve that is seen. Posterior ciliary arteries have to be cleared off by gentle dissection. You simply push these away to a side and land on the surface of the optic nerve. Use neurosurgical cotonide to make sure that the orbital fat doesn't come in the way. You can see the gush of CSF. When we made that optic nerve incision with an MVR blade, that was a vertical incision along the course of the optic nerve. One more similar incision parallel to it, about 3 to 4 millimeter. And then you put in a Sinsky hook and the adhesions between the optic nerve and the optic nerve sheath are lysed by lifting up the optic nerve sheath and not touching the optic nerve per se. And then you still have to do some work. You have to cut a small window of the optic nerve sheath to make sure that it doesn't fibrosis and close the nice large ostium that you made. So optic nerve sheath fenestration, that is a segment of the optic nerve that is removed, can easily be performed by transconjunctival approach. Transconjunctival approach is not just good for tumors, it's also good for trauma, the fractures, and optic nerve sheath fenestration. That's the conjunctiva put back together using glue. Quick approach, and post-operatively, you can see that the optic nerve, even in the other eye, it reduces because there is a contralateral effect as well. So transcutaneous optic, orbitotomy, we have upper lid crease incision, which goes by the name of Harris. Subbro incision goes by the name of Benedict. Subciliary incision doesn't have a name in the upper lid. Lower lid eyelid crease incision goes by the name of Davis. Then there is Lynch incision and vertical lid split incision called Baron-Smith. Now, these are simple orbital dermoids, extracoronal or intracoronal, can be approached either directly or by a lid crease incision. So if you are a general ophthalmologist watching this, if you have a small dermoid in the supranasal aspect, you really don't have to worry. You can make a direct incision. So direct incision is just like that, right on top of the lesion, a curvilinear incision, which is not going to be cosmetically bad. You can always do lid crease incision, but if you're worried about having to pass through the skin orbicularis plane, etc., direct incision is very good. So when you approach a dermoid, you always lift the tissues and cut. And you leave some tissue right on top of the dermoid so that you can hold it. And you always hold tissues around the dermoid and dissect, not to hold the dermoid itself. And dissection can be a combination of sharp and blunt dissection. As long as you do everything under visualization, that's fine. As you approach the vascular pedicle, you have to be careful. And vascular pedicle is ideally cauterized and cut. And simply have to close this with a few sutures. Now, if the same lesion were to be on the lateral side, dermoid excision suprotemporal, and this was adherent to the periosteum, and this is actually on either side of the bro, as you see here. So you can make a crescentric incision under the bro. Again, a direct approach. Superficial scratch skin incision. Lift the skin up and then make orbicularis dissection. I would do this in all patients with dermoid where you don't want to suddenly go posterior and hit the capsule of the dermoid. You go layer by layer, lifting it and then undermining in the suborbicularis plane around the dermoid inferiorly and then on the medial side of the dermoid, step by step, then inferiorly, infralaterally. Any fibrous band is cut with scissors suprotemporally. Then you have to identify where exactly is it attached to the periosteum or the suture line. That area has to be meticulously dissected. But before you go to the suture, sometimes dermoid can rupture when you approach it at the suture. Your superficial dissection should be nearly complete. Then only you approach the suture. All under visualization. Any fibrous band is being excised with scissor. And as you approach the suture and the pedicle, you bring in a bipolar cautery to cauterize and remove the lesion completely. So this is a direct approach for a suprotemporal dermoid. But you have to be careful with a dermoid because it may have a extension into the extraorbital space. Like this patient has a small defect in the orbit bone here. If a dermoid were to be not completely palpable and doesn't move well, like this patient did not have a visible dermoid and did not move well, then you should suspect that there is a dumbbell dermoid or an extraorbital component. 3D CTs can actually show you that there is a defect through which there was an extraorbital component. So if you have a gross dumbbell dermoid like this, so this is the extraorbital component, this is the intraorbital component, then you make osteotomy on both the sides of it. So I would make osteotomy here as well as here and then excise the entire lesion in one single piece along with the intervening defective bone. So the entire lesion, extraorbital, intraorbital and the defective bone are all excised together in one piece. In a deep-seated supranasal lesion, I haven't used vertical lid split incision for several years now. This is an old video, obviously. So this will show a vertical lid split incision. Now we have alternative approaches where you create a iatrogenic lid laceration. So you split the lid vertically like that till you reach the superior fornix. This is an extremely old video of mine. You can see the quality is quite shady. So you go to the superior fornix all by splitting the lid. And once you go to the superior fornix, you don't injure the LPS, superior oblique, etc. Go right to the apex of the lesion and everything else is the same. When you do orbitotomy, you have to do everything under visualization. There is no scope for blind dissection. As you apply a cryo probe, separate out rest of the adhesions, gently support the lesion from the back and wriggle the lesion out. You don't have to be in a hurry to pull a lesion out. You have to wriggle it out very, very gently. Everything under a microscope assisted visualization with good illumination. And if there's a fibrous band, only that is cut. Everything else is separated from the lesion. So that is the lid split incision. All that you finally have to do is to suture the lid split. Suture the lid split like you would suture a lid laceration. Exactly like that. Use marginal sutures and suture the lid split. That's how you suture it, exactly like you do for a lid laceration. So that was vertical lid split. For anterior orbitotomy, we can use a subro incision. I don't think I'll go into that video because it's just the same. But I would end with showing one more video of a superior incision. Let's see if this is this. Yeah, forget about it. We'll go to the next one. Yeah, this is a lacrimal gland tumor, but this patient had a bone defect. So when you have a lacrimal gland tumor with a bone defect, it could be anything. You know, it could be a pleomorphic adenoma, it could be pleomorphic adenoma with carcinoma. So whenever there is a bone defect, you don't want to do a lid crease incision. Whenever you suspect that there is a possibility of malignancy, you don't want to do a lid crease incision, you want to do a direct approach. So this is one such incision, supratemporal direct approach right on top of the lesion. That's the skin incision. Now we are doing dissection of the orbicularis, relatively smaller incision. So layer by layer approach, then we are approaching the superior orbital margin. We're approaching the periosteum and lateral dissection in preparation for a possible bone cut. You don't do a bone cut, but you always make provision for it. Make a periosteal incision about 3 to 4 millimeter from the superior orbital margin and extend it quite laterally because tumor is all the way lateral. Then you dissect the periosteum of the orbital wall until you reach arcus marginalis, which is a soft tissue landmark. Then wherever there is a fissure, foramen or a suture, you have to be careful dissecting. That's the frontozygomatic suture, where you're careful not to rupture the periosteum prematurely. Then now having done the periosteal dissection, you have to take off this sharp overlying bone. This is called marginotomy or the Goldberg technique, where you simply punch out the supratemporal sharp margin of the bone so that you get a posterior view without having to cut the bone. Then you use a set of sutures for retraction of the flaps so that your dependence on the orbital retractor is minimal. Then you make an incision in the periorbita. You see that I'm holding the periorbita up and making the incision, and whenever I pass the scissor under it, the scissor is lifted up and cut so that there is no accidental damage to the capsule or the pseudocapsule of the tumor. Scissor is always lifted and cut. This is a T-shaped incision. The horizontal limb of the T is crescent rig along the superior orbital margin, or exactly following the superior orbital margin. That's the vertical limb of the T, a small vertical radial cut. You hold both the edges of that vertical cut and rip towards the orbital apex. So basically you're making a T into a V-shaped window. Then you hold the edge of the periosteum and dissect it off this tumor. So all that we are doing is holding the periosteum and dissecting the periosteum off the tumor without holding the tumor or the capsule of the tumor itself. Never touch a tooth forceps to the tumor because it may breach the capsule. Now there is a periosteal tag there that can be cut with scissor under visualization away from the tumor, of course. And if it's a vascular pedicle, you bring in your bipolar cautery. So if you see a blood vessel there, never cut it with scissors. Simply cauterize it before you cut it. Then you ballot the tumor and see where exactly it may still be adherent. Seems to be adherent slightly on the medial side. So you go back to the medial side and explore what it is adherent to. Is it adherent to any of the crucial structures? We already bridled the superior rectus and lateral rectus. So you can see if it's adherent to any of the muscles. Then you put in a cryoprobe. You can see a nice large ice ball forming. Start moving the tumor and you assess where else it could be adherent to posteriorly. So in that direction, you have to go to dissect it and you support the tumor, not to pull it off, but simply support the tumor from the back. Now, as we come out, we see posterior structures being visible. All these are dissected and a vascular pedicle is cauterized. That's how the tumor comes out. So this is a process that you have to go through for every tumor. And then wait for hemostasis for 4 to 5 minutes of external pressure, and head end goes up. Then hypotensive anesthesia effect is reversed. The patient has to have systolic of at least 100 before we start suturing. suture the periosteum and orbicularis and skin. So that is how it is. So I think I can stop here and we can continue rest of it next time. Okay, Seema?
Thank you, sir. And for this very comprehensive talk, and I'm sure some of the confusion must have been cleared out. The doubts and that. There are a couple of questions. Can we take some of the questions? So there are two questions on the vascular tumors. What is your experience with the stereotactic radiation for cavernous hemangioma?
Very good, actually. It reduces the size of the tumor by about 60-70%. So there is a decompression effect. So I wouldn't do it for tumors which are anteriorly located or in the mid-orbit or short of the apex. But for tumors which are in a crucial location, it's a good option.
Okay. The next one is on what is the dose of bleomycin that you use for sclerotherapy?
Bleomycin, you know, you can use in one unit per ml. So you can inject it depending on the volume of the tumor. If it's a macrocystic lymphangioma, you inject about, so you estimate the volume of the tumor and inject about 1/3 to 1/4 of the volume of the tumor. If it's a microcystic lymphangioma, you aspirate the contents of the lesion, measure it, and half the contents. Suppose you get about 7 cc of aspirate, you can inject maximum of 3.5 cc. But if it's an intraconal lymphangioma, I wouldn't want to over-inject because there is always this theoretical risk of macular ischemia and optic nerve issues. So for an intraconal lymphangioma, even if it means 2 or 3 injections, that is okay. But you would want to inject not more than 1 cc in the intraconal space, that is one unit. If it's an extraconal lesion, I would go up to 3.5 to 4 units, that is 3.5 to 4 cc.
Okay. One very general question, why don't you use a radio frequency for giving a direct incision instead of the blade?
Mm-hmm. Why don't we use
a radio frequency to give the skin incision? Why don't you use radio frequency for skin incision instead of a direct blade?
You can use radio frequency for skin incision also, but it has a little more tendency to scar than use a Barbakan. I find Barbakan. BP knife gives you the most regular of wounds. You know, it is such a sharp, nice cut wound that if you are keen on cosmesis, then you would want to use a Barbakan knife. If it's a literary incision, it doesn't matter. But if it's a direct approach, then Barbakan knife is better in terms of final scar.
And
you
on dermoid, what is your approach in the dermoid as an intracranial extension also?
Which one?
If dermoid also has an intracranial extension.
Dermoid has an intracranial extension. So if it is extradural, then I would do the same approach. But if it is infiltrated the dura and it is gone beyond the dura, which is very rare, then I wouldn't want to do it. I would take the help of a neurosurgeon. Okay.
And is it necessary to do a CT scan for all cases of dermoid?
All cases of?
Dermoid.
Yes, of course. Every patient of dermoid would get a scan, except if it is completely palpable. That means you can reach the posterior aspect of the lesion. With your fingers, you can lift it up. And if it is so anterior, then there is actually no need to do a CT scan. But if it is even has limited mobility is little restricted, then you have to do a CT scan to see why is the motility restricted? Is it extending to the suture? Is it extending through the suture? Is there any extraorbital component? So you would want to do CT scan in all patients where there is posterior aspect is not palpable and mobility is restricted.
Okay. So there's one request for showing a video of dumbbell dermoid. I think we're going to cover it in the next session.
Yeah, I'll get it and cover it.
Okay. So how can we differentiate between cavernous hemangioma and a hemangiopericytoma on imaging?
On imaging, unless you do a contrast-enhanced imaging, it is sometimes difficult. In cavernous hemangioma, contrast enhancement is moderate. So that means that, say, suppose pre-contrast tonsil value is about 30 to 40. If it goes to 60 to 70, then most likely it is cavernous hemangioma. But post-contrast tonsil value is almost tripling, indicates that it is a highly vascular lesion. Then that is unlikely to be cavernous hemangioma. That is most likely to be a hemangiopericytoma. This is on CT scan. CT scan will also have one more sign, that is central cavitation. So if the lesion is isodense or uniformly dense in the periphery and mid-periphery of the lesion, but the center part of the lesion has a cavitation, or there is an eccentric cavitation, that is just a large vascular space on a non-contrast CT scan, that is also an indication that it is hemangiopericytoma. Other differential feature would be on MRI. MRI is actually much better than CT scan in differentiating cavernous hemangioma from hemangiopericytoma, especially diffusion weighted MRI flow characteristics are, there are standard ways in which radiologists would tell you whether it is cavernous hemangioma or hemangiopericytoma on advanced MRI techniques. So that's how you differentiate.
Okay. Another one on lymphangioma. Hmm? So if a lymphangioma is extending to both the superior and the inferior quadrant of the orbit, so do you give multiple small volume injection, or you give to just a single site to the largest cyst if it's a macrocystic?
Yeah, if it is encysted, then you want to aspirate. If there are two separate cysts which are not communicating, often lymphangioma communicate at some level. So if you start aspirating a superior larger cyst, then you might find that the inferior cyst also fairly collapses. If that is the situation, you inject only at one point. After having aspirated the largest cyst, the smaller inferior cyst doesn't collapse at all. That means that it is a loculated cyst. There again, there is a reason to aspirate again by a different approach. So depends on how much communication is there between the two components.
One more question, sir. Can bleomycin be used for dumbbell dermoids?
Dumbbell dermoid, I haven't used bleomycin, but sodium tetradecyl sulfate has been used, and foam sclerotherapy has been used for dermoids. Especially after evacuating the contents completely, you can use sclerotherapy. For dermoids, which are difficult to approach, or patient is concerned about cosmesis, but there's always a chance of recurrence. With dermoids, sclerotherapy works fine. But, it all depends on the content of the dermoid. It is good to estimate on radiology that, okay, the content of the dermoid is so fluid that it will come out. But it is not always so. The content of the dermoid may have a lot of hair, a lot of glandular elements that may be residual. And when you inject a sclerosing agent in such a situation, there might be partial sclerosis and the dermoid may actually recur. So whenever it is possible, surgery is the treatment of choice. But where surgery can cause cosmetic deformity or functional problems, then aspiration of the dermoid is an option along with foam sclerotherapy.
So the next one, again, continuing with the bleomycin. This one is from Dr. Ramesh Murthy. And he's asking, are there any specific situation where we should not inject bleomycin into a lymphangioma?
Well, the only situation is a purely intraconal lesion without any cosmetic or functional problem. That is a risk that we are taking. If there is a cosmetic or a functional problem, injecting into an intraconal lesion is fine. But I would use less than one unit, as I said. But without any major issue, so child has 2 millimeter of proptosis, which is not cosmetically bothering, if there is no functional problem, we best not inject an intraconal lymphangioma.
And does it work well for microcystic and macrocystic, equally well? Are there any alternatives?
Yeah, microcystic has the best prognosis. Microcystic has the worst prognosis. Macrocystic has the best prognosis. So if you inject a macrocystic lymphangioma, there is about 80 to 90% chance that with 1 to 3 injections, the lymphangioma will be completely sclerosed. But if it's a microcystic lymphangioma, it might give partial reduction in volume. That means that from a 4 millimeter proptosis, the child may get back to 2 millimeter proptosis. There may not be complete resolution. and there are more number of injections that are required.
And how do you differentiate between a microarray macrocystic lymphangioma on imaging? Because radiologists often don't comment on it.
Yeah, well, you have to ask them to comment. And it is evident also, macrocystic lymphangioma will have a, you know, lucent space, that is a cystic area, which is quite large in at least one part of the lesion, or the entire lesion may be of cystic in nature, except for a small solid component, that is macrocystic. In microcystic, it is like a sponge or a honeycomb appearance, you know, cut sponge or cut honeycomb appearance, where there are small, small cavitations, but not large enough to contain blood. It is a spongy architecture of lymphangioma that we anyway know. So macrocystic and microcystic and combined, these are the three variants. Mixed variant is the most common. There is hardly ever a pure microcystic or a pure macrocystic. But then there is always what is called a predominantly macrocystic, which is very good for sclerotherapy. Predominantly microcystic is okay for sclerotherapy, but it doesn't respond so well.
And how do you decide on a repeat injection bleomycin when you decide that this patient needs?
So I would see the child back after 6 to 8 weeks. And if the response is good, and if the cosmesis is better, if the child hasn't bled again, then I wouldn't do anything. But if the response is modest, then I would do the second injection between 6 to 8 weeks. And the third injection after about 3 months from the time of second injection. Space out injections, not at regular 6 weekly interval. Wait for 6 to 8 weeks after each injection and then see the response. And only if it is required, then you go for the second and third injection.
Any specific post-operative care after the injection?
So everything is on lymphangioma today. Yeah, post-operative care is steroids. One single injection of dexamethasone on the table. And on the next day, if there is a lot of edema or if there is any disc patient already had a short optic disc, say the patient had a disc edema, then you would want to give steroids. If there is no such thing, then one single intraoperative injection is what I give.
So two more questions on dermoid now. So in cases of dermoid with a bony involvement, do we need to keratoconvulse the bone in all cases? And I think the one related to it is, if suppose there is an the involvement of the bone is forming a small cavity inside the bone, so do you do anything to cover that cavity so that there is no future incarceration of the orbital tissues inside that, like a small fossa which is formed?
Right. So you curate the bone. See, suppose it's an intraosseous or a partially intraosseous dermoid. You have to very aggressively curate the bone. In fact, I would not use a curette. I would use a burr, diamond burr or a fluted burr, to completely remove that irregular layer of bone, in which there will be some epithelial elements, cellular elements of the dermoid. So curettage will never be regular, but when you use a burr, you can actually make a nice layer of the bone completely. You can remove it completely and leave that area of the bone bare. You don't want to actually fill it up with anything else. You really don't have to do it unless it's an inferior orbital dermoid. If it's an inferior orbital dermoid, if you have destroyed the floor, then there is a possibility of the eye going down into hypoglobus, then you would want to support the floor. But if it's medial lateral, you really don't have to do anything to the bone. There is no incarceration and tissues heal very well.
A little confusion over the nomenclature of vascular malformation. So now you call it a cavernous hemangioma now or a cavernous malformation? Which classification should we call?
I can use any classification. It doesn't matter. I can cover it in detail next time. But basically, cavernous hemangioma is a term that has got established in the literature. You simply don't want to change it because, you know, things are evolving. So you can call it a malformation, but I would still call it cavernous hemangioma because it's easier.
Okay. About the transconjunctival incision, how do you avoid entropion following a transconjunctival approach orbital surgeries?
For lower lid entropion? No, it doesn't actually happen. It's hardly possible. You know, actually, suturing also matters. When you finally suture it, if you simply close only the conjunctiva and nothing else, then the chance of entropion, ectropion is hardly ever there. But if you start meddling with the lower lid retractors, the septum, etc., then there might be some kind of a cicatrization. Otherwise, it generally doesn't happen. I haven't seen a case of lower lid entropion following transgenital approach.
Okay, so I think that's it. I don't see any questions. Dr. Ramesh Murthy has in fact answered why you call it a cavernous hemangioma, because that's a PET tumor. That's what he's saying. So one more has come. In cases of bilateral papilledema requiring optic nerve fenestration, would you do both eyes together in one stage or stagger them?
No, currently recommendation is that you do the worst eye first and then wait and look at the other eye also, because there is contralateral effect with the optic nerve sheath fenestration. If you opened a 3 to 4 millimeter window, as in you saw in my case, we just did one eye and the other eye also disc edema reduced. Contralateral effect is known. So you wait for about 2 to 3 weeks for contralateral effect. And if the patient doesn't have contralateral effect, then you do the other eye. It's risky to do both eyes because there might be, you know, a possibility of bilateral blindness.
So I think that's it.
That's it.
Once again, sir, for taking our time for this.
Thank you.
We will look forward to the next session. And just a little change from the schedule. The next tumor orbital approach session, instead of Sunday, it's going to be on Monday. That's 15th of June, same time. So we'll send out the mailer, the modified mailer, and the Zoom link to all the participants. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone, for joining in.
Thank you.